podcast, and I'm aware that there's a few seats vacant at the table. I think we're going to be joined, but we will start this week, as we should start at 6. I've had apologies from Barefoot Fish. I haven't had any apologies. Are there any to register?
There are apologies from Castleberry and
So, what we're looking at the moment is, in a nutshell, everything's on plan, but we do face some stiff headwinds as a business. They were noted in the plan, but we're seeing that as schools are now looking at their financial plans for next year, we're seeing a lot more focus on what they're prepared to spend. And given all of our services are voluntary or discretionary spend items with schools, we don't provide any statutory. Then our job is to convince them that we provide the best value option for them. And to do that, the nature of essential as you set it up, helps us tremendously. Because when I sit in front of head teachers, governors, I know many of you will be governors as well, I can look them in the eye and say, we are a community interest company. Been set up with a mission which is to help improve outcomes for children and young people. That's it. Any profit we make, and we will make a profit because that drives us to be more efficient, is reinvested back in our services and back into projects and initiatives within our schools. It's a very strong message for us. And then combine that with the values we set the company up with, which are about customer focus, innovation, and best value for money guarantee, which is, I'll come to that in a minute. I can stand in front of our customers with my hand on my heart and say, we are absolutely doing everything we can to make sure we're delivering great services at the best possible price to help you make your budgets go further. Examples of that are obviously catering, where we turn around the catering service has built a lot of credibility that that Central can now use in the other services we offer. For example, we did the school development, so what was known as EQ, Education Quality, we've now broadened that out into how we support schools in their curriculum, learning, teaching, leadership, and development of their staff, their governing bodies in terms of training. It's a package of services we offer there. But as with all our other services, we are under intense pressure from competitors who are offering schools similar services. For example, our main competitor from Cheshire recently wrote to all Wirral schools offering a large discount on their existing Cheshire prices. So we have obviously said we guarantee best value for money. So we went away, looked at what we do, looked at our mission, looked at our business plan and see what we could do to respond to that, and we did very strongly. Because as I said, our mission is bigger, so our values are best value for money, we stand by that. We have to do things differently, go away, sharpen our pencil, think about doing things differently. We will respond, because that's the freedom we were set up to do. You guys have the foresight to understand that's the environment that we operate in, and we need the freedom to be able to do that. So that is already helping us be more competitive, respond quickly to any moves by competitors who are trying to enter our schools. I quite happily sit there in front of the heads and say, it's a private educational consultancy. The money goes out of the system, the money with us goes into the system, and we guarantee you, we are policy experts, we will give you the best advice. So we're using our freedom already to help us be more competitive and keep on track to deliver our plan, which I think was also created Cabinet in terms of the financial pathway we're on over the next 5 years, to make sure we are a sustainable, secure business that employs a lot of people across Wirral and Cheshire, and that we continue to provide that good quality employment. So they are that's how our mission and our values is helping us right now, day to day. The conversations I have on the way in here, it's healthy, that's how we're operating. But the other thing I want to just talk through with you as well is our governance structure. So again, if you cast your minds back to the original cabinet report, and I included some elements of it in the report that I circulated, is how we run as a business to give us that freedom, but also as shareholders, both authorities, to have an interest in what we do and our ultimate say of what we do. So we have shareholder boards, so there's a diagram in the report that shows, again, it actually shows this committee in that report as well. So our shareholder board with our portfolio holder, which is Tony Smith, meets four times a year, so quarterly. And the main role of that shareholder board, as with any, you think of it as any kind of investor board, is to A, sign off our business plan, and then we report to that shareholder board the rest of the year to see how we're tracking against performance against that plan. So we have a board of directors which run the company. I sit on the board. We also have two shareholder nominated directors. So from the Wirral, that's David Armstrong, but he sits as an independent non-exec. So those of you familiar with company law will understand that David, although appointed by the shareholder, sits in his own capacity as an independent director. And Mark Parkinson, the Director of Education for Cheshire West, is the shareholder appointee for Cheshire West. We then have a vacant chair, which we are in the process of shortlisting candidates, potential candidates for that position, which we will then recommend to our shareholders. groups, what they're doing to bringing that knowledge and expertise into our boardroom discussions, making sure that the strategy we lay out for the business is the right one in the long term for all of our schools, both with Cheshire and Wirral, and then beyond, should we go into other areas as well. But it's important that we get that expertise into the boardroom to make sure that our strategy is delivering what our customers want. So then, obviously, we have a company operating board where I sit with my management team on a day-to-day basis, driving performance across all six main service areas that we have. So that, in a nutshell, is the where we're up to as a company and how it operates. And I'm quite happy to answer any questions.
Thanks very much, Ian. Yes, I see Walter indicated.
Thank you.
Tony.
Thanks for the presentation, Ian. I'm sure all of us on the committee will wish you all the very best in as you develop the services for our schools. I wanted to ask you about in the services that you provide, you mentioned the residential stroke outward bound and learning outside the classroom support. What sort of services are they?
We have six residential centres, which from Wirral you put in the Oakland Centre in Snowdonia. Cheshire put in four small centres within Cheshire, in Tadpole, in Tesco, Tadpole, Beeston, Bursley and Delamere. So they're typically aimed at primary schools, Key Stage 1, Key Stage 2. Typically your first night away will be say a Tadpole Centre. We then have the Oakland Centre, which is very much in the heart of Snowdonia. You go and do your real outbound activities. And then we have our largest centre, which is the Conway Centre on Anglesey. Oakland has about 45 beds. Conway Centre has just under 500 beds. So there we take whole year groups of secondary schools. We have, it's a National Trust of Property that we lease just on the Menai Strait, so we go even from sailing out of the bound, all the activities you would imagine. But we also have a very rapidly growing part of our offer there, which is not just focused on traditional outward bound, but arts, so performing arts and visual arts, where we look at, you have groups coming through secondary school, year groups, GCSE, A-level, but they'll come for intense weeks either to do their project work ready for their exams. We bring in artists to work with them to produce the pieces of work, so we give them a very different, intense experience. So we're using the facilities not just for the traditional, so we're broadening out how pupils get a benefit from facilities, and also, as far as we can say, you're getting better utilisation of them as well.
If I just come back on that, Jeff, if I just declare my interest as I'm a founder of a club and I've chaired it for many years, I presume these different centres that you're now responsible for, they've each got different ways of different services and different levels of service.
Yes.
And if I just finish off by saying that the reason I raised this, I thought I didn't know you were responsible for Oakland's or the new company. Some of the friends of, there's a group, the Friends of Oaklands, and they were concerned that the Oaklands experience, which is essentially a Snowdonia experience, you know, canoeing and mountaineering, abseiling, boat walking, that may be lost, and there might be a sort of evening out across all the centres. Is it your intention to keep the sort of individual attributes of those centres?
Yeah, absolutely. What we're doing is we're segmenting our residential offer to accentuate the different experiences that we can do. So we've also talked to schools in terms of life stages. As you go through your school career, how you can start to enjoy our residential centres as you go through Key Stage 1, Key Stage 2, Key Stage 3. So you're not going to the same centre every year, which some schools traditionally do. It's about understanding how you move through on a journey and the challenges and learning opportunities and leadership opportunities and all things that go with that happening. Oakland fits absolutely with that because it has a unique part in our portfolio. does do is give you access to the real activity. So that fits with how we offer that solution. So it sits within the portfolio, providing some of the other centres don't. We play with that in terms of life stages, because they go through typically stage 3, 4, and into 6 form. And we'll retain each unique characteristic, because what we want is pupils to go on multiple journeys, not just, you know, a year 6 trip, a year 7 get to know you trip, and maybe one in a 6 form if you do the, you know, Duke of Edinburgh. Ideally for us, you know, quite honestly, in terms of how I grow the revenue in those centres, is getting classes to go there more frequently because they get the benefit of doing that, and then experiencing different things through their journey as they go. And Oakland's provides a very real hands-on aspect that they don't get in any other centre.
Tony
and Treena,
I've got
two more.
Any on
the
side?
And
Alan. So
if we could,
and Angie. So
if we could
just be a little bit more concise.
Hi, it's just we I'm probably a person interested in this as well. But we heard at the full council that the Mayor's team wasn't brought back under delegated funding. Mm. And it's a real essential service, you know, that's offered across what a council to them, to the schools. Do you think that would be something?
I'm absolutely sure there's no conflict of interest here. To
yeah, say that. I do declare personal interest.
Okay. I'm not sure.
All right. I'll leave it.
Treena.
Okay, thanks, Chair. It's just really just a comment, you know, that that I'm pleased that our council, you know, who are at the moment facing the biggest onslaught of government cuts in their history, and are using their mission to become joint shareholders with a non-for-profit organisation such as yourselves, with Cheshire West, and transferring, you know, the 1,200 members and staff over, you know, otherwise, you know, we would have, you know, faced huge redundancies. And looking at the statements from the pupils and staff from the schools that receive this service, it's a good testament to, you know, on how good a service you are providing, so that's great. In relation to the key challenges, the school finances and the increased costs, I'd hope that, you know, your governance arrangements and the expertise in place, that this would help mitigate in any circumstances. And I just wish you every success going forward in the future.
Alan and
Angie. Thanks, Chair. I just really wanted to ask or explore. I mean, you rightly say it's a difficult market out there, and it's there's a number of sort of headwinds coming your way, and competition you talked about from Cheshire and one thing and another. And yes, you have got, I think, more freedom to be more competitive, and I really, that's really what I wanted to understand. I know that you go and sell your products to school governors and others on the basis, which is perfectly a good basis, which is that it's a not-for-profit organisation and the money remains within the education sector, as it were. But what else are you able to bring that, when it was a council-operated service, council wasn't able to provide? And in other words, what is it, what edge have you got that will enable you against some of those big players that are out there trying to muscle into the market, that you'll be able to compete against them?
Thank you. I think just like to just, I think it's a couple of times there, we're not a not-for-profit, that's a different class of type of organisation. We're a community interest company, so we do make profit, but we have a social mission, so we reinvest all the profit back into our mission. What do we offer? We've set ourselves up as a company, but what drives us to be different? Firstly, it's the culture and the values and how we operate, the pace we operate at, how we operate in terms of as a team, and the personal responsibility and accountability that people are now starting to take. We talk to schools, and we talk about the whole school approach. So previously, each service just focused on its own individual service. Clear barriers. We talk about whole school service. So if I was over to school this afternoon, two schools this afternoon, I don't talk about catering anymore. I talk about your whole one of the key Ofsted, you know, exception criteria, health and wellbeing, is, you know, quite rightly, is an emerging part of that. So I will talk health and wellbeing. Talk to me about your plan to improve the health and wellbeing of pupils in this school, because I can give them a great nutritious meal which meet national standards and go beyond that. Then, because we have learning outside the classroom, we can get them off their chairs, we can get them out on school visits, we can get them out to residential centres. We provide PE, either directly through quality PE teaching, or we help train and develop your staff to provide better quality PE activities. We provide all the swimming services for Wirral. So in terms of what we offer you, I wouldn't come talk to you about the quality of your catering. We talk about, as an example, all health and wellbeing, feed them well, get them off their chairs, get them out of the classrooms, enjoying visits, activities, learning things about themselves, great PE, more active, swimming, and then also within that, you know, their wellbeing aspect, all of the safeguarding to make sure we're providing the training, the advice, and the support, so it's not just their physical health that we're contributing to, but their mental health as well. So we take a whole school approach to health and wellbeing, leadership and management, both to the head and to governing bodies as well. So those of you who are governors, we've sent to the schools copies of our latest brochure to see it. But if you're interested in how you think your school needs help with leadership and management, we've sectioned the brochure so you can just turn to it and you can see what we do to improve leadership management, what we do to improve teaching and learning, aspiration and attainment. We've segmented it into the key Ofsted focused areas to allow schools to understand how, by working with Essential, we can help all areas of your school plan, not just talk about one individual service or try selling one thing. That's it.
Hi, I just had a question in terms of the governance arrangements. So, in the report, it talks about reserve decisions, so decisions that the board of directors must refer to.
Yes.
Kind of council is the shareholder. Can you give us some examples about what those reserve decisions?
Yes, reserve matters are absolutely typical in any business setup where the investors allow the board freedom to make decisions, but then certain things which could significantly influence the value of their investment, they say, actually, we want to make sure we have a say on that. So appointing the directors is a reserved decision. So that's ultimately how investors influence the direction the company's going is by appointing the directors or dismissing directors. It's the reserved decision is signing off the annual business plan. So we will submit business plan. The shareholder board will then approve or not that, or the feedback on that plan. Anything which, I was trying to remember, there's about
28,
any major decision which includes investment of about £250,000 is reserved. Anything which includes exiting part of business which has a material effect on the plan would go and consult.
Fellow program director for Healthy Wirral, and I'm
on some specific pieces of work that we've been doing, but I thought it might be helpful just to remind you. Some of you have probably heard of Healthy Wirral, because many of the colleagues around the table here have been very involved in it. Some of you may not have done. This is an initiative that's being run through NHS England to be a Vanguard site. Wirral was chosen to be a Vanguard site. And what's happened is all partner organisations have come together from health and social care. So we've got our partners here around the table, and together with partners from Cheshire Wirral Partnership, the Community Trust and the Acute Trust, and then the Clinical Commissioning Group, have all come together with the aim of improving the health and wellbeing of people on Wirral wherever they live, because it's recognising those health inequalities that you're probably very familiar with. So we've had an opportunity to bid for funding because we are a Vanguard site, which is great, but that is just a compriming funding arrangement that acknowledges that whilst we're trying to transform services, we do need some compriming money to set up services, for example, community-based services, while we've still got people in hospital care, because we are really trying to drive care as much as we can towards supporting people through primary care, community care, or through voluntary sector and people's own self-care. So I'll come back to that because that's quite a key part of the presentation. There's three aims we are trying to achieve. So improving clinical outcomes, ensuring that people, you know, are well. Improving people's experience wherever they are in our sort of organisations. And efficiency. So again, you'll be very familiar with all those areas. So our programme is quite extensive. We're looking at things, for example, like prevention and self-care. We're looking at integration of our services, of our teams in the community. So, for example, Cheshire Wirral Partnership, the CT, the Community Trust, and social care teams coming together in community hubs to wrap around patient people, because it's people in the community. And we're expanding that offer. So recently, the end of life care team have joined those teams. Tissue viability services have joined the team, which is really important. Some of those people can end up in hospital. We don't want them there. We want care in the community. So we're continuing to expand that integrated offer. We're looking at new models of care, specifically for people who have diabetes and respiratory care. And we're looking at end-to-end pathways of care. So trying to stop people just developing with diabetes in the first place often starts with children, and it was just great to sit and listen to that presentation talking about healthy eating and encouraging young people, because certainly when we've spoken to them through consultation, they know what they should be doing. It's how we keep that home as they get a bit older. So we're looking at the whole pathway, prevention, supporting people through primary care, and really trying to avoid hospital care. But if we do need people to go into hospital care, things like end-of-life care, where people are ending up in hospital now, how do we ensure people can die in their place of choice? That's also very, very important. We've got a number of enabling work streams. The biggest one is really looking at information technology and how we create a new care record for Wirral. So if you're a resident of Wirral, we are looking at developing a care record that pulls in your records from hospital, social care, community care, GPs, and you can view them all in one place. So that brings great advantages in terms of, for example, an elderly person turning up in the emergency department, the staff being able to look at the screen and see that they've got a package of care available. And that just saves so many issues, I can't begin to tell you. Likewise, GPs can see that the patient's been to the emergency department or has social care or has mental health care input. We're doing a lot of work around information governance, and we are going to be going out doing a consultation with the public about the new care record in about April. We're just preparing that work at the moment. But the other enabling work stream I want to talk to you about tonight is really the consultation work we've been doing in January this year to ask local people what matters to the general public, some work groups, so people who've got hearing difficulties, people who were in specialist care, perhaps got mental health challenges. So we did workshops. We also got survey responses online from people. We gathered thousands of post-it notes. We can't move in our office at the moment, fighting our way through them. We had 200 face-to-face conversations, and 29,000 people looked at our video on Facebook, which I think is really, really positive. And it also tells us, I think, that we are sort of changing with, you know, more people are using that form of media, and we need to respond in that way. So we did get a lot of response to these questions. We asked people, what matters most to you for your health and well-being? What do you think needs to change? What can you do? Because we were really, really keen to ask people what contribution we thought they could make. And then how do we keep them involved and informed in the work that we're doing? What we've been able to do at this point is pull out some key themes, and we're doing some deeper dive on some of the work, on each area of the work. But it's things sort of split into about three areas. People having confidence in the services we provide in health and social care, that it's one service, and that they are able to enjoy and use their community and their community assets really well. So confidence was something that was very personal about people's, I need to know I can eat well, that I'm happy, spiritually I'm happy, and that I'm well supported to have a happy life, which, you know, that resonates with me. They wanted to have confidence in personal interactions that they might have with our staff. So it might be social workers, for example, it might be doctors, nurses, it could be anybody they come into contact with. But confidence that those people will listen to them and take on board what they're saying. It was interesting, they didn't always expect them to solve the problem, but they did want them to empathise and go, yeah, that's really, really tough, I know. And then, very important, confidence in the future of the NHS. At this point, they weren't talking about, they didn't talk about social care, they just said the NHS. But they said, we don't want the NHS to go, we want it to be there. And I think we were able to assure them that this isn't about getting rid of the NHS. We're working with, the IT company we're working with are American, and some people said, oh, well, clearly we're going to privatise. Absolutely not. We're going to use the best parts of what we've learned from the American system, but, you know, it's to adapt to our own system here in Wirral and in the UK. People wanted a service that was accessible, so they talked a lot about being able to get to see their GP. But actually, when we did a bit deeper digging, we found that what they wanted was a person they could go to with their issue and say, can you help me? And I think what came out was that people really recognised that maybe the GP, for example, wasn't the right person. So you might have people working in the community, community connectors who know all about your local services, and they could be just as useful. Or somebody from Alzheimer's Society, for example, age concerned. Actually, they wanted somebody to sit and talk to them about their challenges or difficulties, and they get frustrated that the GP didn't have the time to do it. But I think this shows us really how we can work differently in the future. They wanted to have a high quality experience, but again, that was about people understanding what was going on for them. And I think a single care record was really important to them. We didn't say to them about a single care record. They said to us, we think you should know all the key things about us. And most of them thought we'd already got one. And so they felt that if it was all in different silos, we wouldn't join things up. So that was good, and that linked in really to the next join up services. But what they meant was that all my concern that some people might not be able to pay to go to them, and they were saying, so how do we make them more accessible? Now, what that brings up is the tension, really, between the challenges we've got with, you know, if we've got limited resource in our health and social care system, how do we make best use of that resource? Because we can't provide everything to everybody. And it's the same in healthcare. I think what this is doing is enabling us to have some good conversations with people about, you know, we can't deliver every type of healthcare, so what is most important to you, and how could you just look after yourself, perhaps with some conditions, so that we don't have to incur that cost in the healthcare system. One of the things that came out that I thought was really, really, quite touching really, was the total sort of commitment to people who are vulnerable and excluded. It really was a theme in many, many groups, particularly around carers, this understanding how difficult it can be for carers, and they fall over, so does the whole sort of system around the individual person who has needs. And there was a real sort of, how can we help them group, because we know that if they can't do their job, it'll just cost us more money. Good provision for mental health, well-being, I think, as well. It wasn't just mental health, it was well-being, and making sure that we have that parity of supporting people's mental well-being, and reducing social isolation, which I know has been a big issue for colleagues here. And we talked about having this social contract with people, about, okay, then, you recognise we've got some pressures, but how can you help us? And that's the question about, well, what could you do? And people really were up for sort of working with us or taking on things themselves. So there was one group from its Heswall area who literally came back the next day saying, so what could we do? How could we pull together our community and work around these things? So I think we've got to really exploit that sort of enthusiasm from certain groups and say, how can we include them in coming up with some of the solutions we need? So I'm very mindful that we've got Health in Wirral, and we're looking at health and well-being. But we've also got the 2020 plan that's in place, which really does sort of dovetail, overlap, and that's the great thing about having people like Fiona, Graham, Julia on the team, because they are constantly reminding us of that. And I just wanted to flag up that there's another piece of work going on called the Sustainability and Transformation Plan. It's a very long title, and this is a plan that NHS England have asked local areas to develop as part of the 5-year forward view, which is about saying how do we have a sustainable healthcare system for the next 5 years. They have tasked clinical commissioning groups, so people like John Deaveling, looking at a local plan for sustainability, but then also a wider footprint of how we work with neighbours such as Cheshire, or work with neighbours as wide as Liverpool and Cheshire to come up with a plan. Now, what we've all said is you can't have all these separate plans, we've absolutely got to pull it all together. So last week we were sitting down with the clinical commissioning group, and Graham was, you know, saying, well, we've got to ensure we pull this in and we pull that in. And I think I just want to give you some assurance that I think we can see that there's a very common thread between all this planning that's going on, be it NHS England and the Vanguard, or the Sustainability Transformation Plan, all the work that's going on in the 2020 plan. And I think we're committed to sort of continuing that and pulling it together. And just looking at the pledges, there was particular areas that we can really see that overlap. So it says me with my glasses, because I can hardly read it. Older people like me with the glasses live well. So one of the things that's definitely coming through as we're doing our sort of research at the moment is an area we really need to focus on is frail older people. Again, it's obvious, isn't it? Care homes and how we ensure that people from care homes are supported in that environment and not blue lighted to hospital as happens so frequently. But also just keeping people who are fitting well but older in that sort of case. So it's about how we work together and deliver that. From the middle circle, that's about technology, and I've been working with the team and we also do communication with the whole general population. We want to explore the social contract with Wirral, and again, we'll work with people. I mean, I know Fiona was one of the first people who flagged this up with me and said around having a deal with people, really, about what do you do, what can we do to support you. So it's a partnership with the local population. We're going to feedback to the public about the outcomes of the work we've done in our sort of survey. And then we're going to have this big conversation around the new Wirral care record so that we can inform people what it's about, so that they can have all their questions about, oh my gosh, is somebody somewhere else going to see my data? We are absolutely making sure that we have made sure we've followed all the regulations and that people don't need to worry about things like that. But if people want to opt out, they are able to do that.